Irene Strikes. She's a long runner, I learned, doing a sprint today. And I believe that's an interesting one. Decisions in not just in life, in decision software, you have to have data for having the right decision or definitely for doing the right thing. So, and that's what Irene is talking about now. Mm-hmm. And yeah, let's have fun with that. An applause.
Thank you. So imagine you have an e-commerce website and are selling some products. And you have quite some visitors, but not all of them are buying something from you. You want to convince more people to buy. So what do? You could make some changes to your website and hope for the best. Maybe more people will start buying your products, right? Or you could find out where on your website people are leaving and make changes to those specific places to keep more people on board. And that's the approach that I'd like to talk to you about today. So you can view your website as a funnel. There are a lot of people at the top of the funnel. On your homepage, your category pages, your product pages. But the further you go down and the closer you'll get to the actual purchase, the fewer people will be there. That means that throughout the funnel, people decide they don't want to buy from you. Maybe they think the product is just not for them, or it's too expensive. Or maybe they prefer another brand. And you won't be able to keep everyone in the funnel from the beginning to the end. But if you know where people are leaving, you know where you can make the changes to make the biggest impact. But how do you know where people are dropping out? This is where Google Analytics and other analytics tools are coming in. In this talk, I will show screenshots from Google Analytics 4, also known as GA4. But of course, there are many alternatives you can use to do the same thing. And in GA4, you can do a so-called funnel exploration. There you can define which steps you want to include in your funnels. So think about your website. Think about the pages you have on your website, the types of pages you have on your website, and about the order in which people navigate between them. So maybe you have an e-commerce website, like in the example I'll be using. But it's just as useful to create funnels if you are the product owner of the support section of a bigger website, or if you have a blog and want more people to subscribe to your newsletter. So to define a step, you can click on the pencil. So back to the traditional e-commerce funnel. Let me explain how I would define that funnel in GA4. So first, I would define the homepage by saying the page path is just a slash. And then I would group all category pages together. In this example, I say the page path of all those pages contain slash, category, slash. And I would group all product pages together. Then I would define the shopping cart, the two steps of the checkout, and the purchase event. And I would end up with something like this. But here are a lot of numbers, a lot of percentages, and some of them are repeated in different places. So I'd like to just take the numbers that I need, get a bit creative in Google Sheets, to end up with something like this. Because you can see really clearly how many people are in each end of the steps of your funnel, and how many of them continue to the next step. And one of the things that stands out in this funnel is that only 24.5% of the people on the shopping cart continue to the checkout. And that's not very much. So why are those people leaving? And maybe more importantly, how can we keep them on board? This funnel is a real example of one of our clients. So we started to think about what we could do to the shopping cart to keep additional people on board. This was the current shopping cart. You can see the selected product at the top, some delivery information in blue in the middle, the total cost at the bottom, and on the right, there are some customer service information. And based on research, we thought maybe people can use some extra reassurance about their upcoming purchase. Maybe you can tell them that they're making a great decision, that they have chosen the right buyer, the right seller, and that they're buying a great product. So then we introduced this element to the cart. Here we told people that they were buying for the lowest price possible, that their order would be delivered fast, and that many happy customers came before them. And then we did an experiment. For a few weeks, we ran an A-B test in which 50% of the people saw the original card and 50% of the people saw the card with the extra reassurance. What do you think happened? It was a winner indeed. We did not only look at the raw data, but also did some statistical analysis to make sure that we were dealing with an actual significant change. And it turned out that more people clicked through to the checkout if they saw the card with the extra reassuring information. And you might remember this number from before. Only 24.5% of the people continued to the checkout. When we implemented the change, it changed. We saw the effects in the funnel. It changed to 26.4%. And I hear you thinking, this is only a 2% point change. But we did see more sales at the end of the funnel. And if you have a lot of visitors, this 2% can already make a big impact. For some of our customers, that would mean maybe €1 million of extra revenue in the next 6 months. But also, if you have a smaller website, taking small changes like these can make a big impact over time, if you just keep improving and improving. So to conclude, use funnels to find out where you lose the biggest group of potential customers, and use experiments to validate that your ideas about how to improve them are actually working and valid. So if you want to start improving your own website, optimize them, make sure to keep the following things in mind. Start by making funnels and checking the click-through rate between the steps. Then find out where you lose the biggest group of potential customers. Take a critical look at those pages and come up with possible solutions for the problems your customers might run into. And then start experimenting with those improvements and implement the things that work well. And then check the funnels after implementation and keep repeating this process over and over again. And it's time now for some final tips and tricks. So to make sure you have the best information to start your optimizations from, and to have a solid base for your optimizations, make sure to keep the following things in mind. Make funnels starting from different points, because not everyone will enter your website through your homepage. We know, for example, that on many e-commerce websites, people enter through product pages or category pages. So make sure to map out funnels starting from there as well. And if there are different paths people can take to subscribe to your newsletter or to add something to their cart, make sure to map out all of those paths people can take. Also look at specific segments like device types, because sometimes you'll see different patterns. But don't use too many segments, because it's also very hard to maintain a website that has many segment-specific features. Thirdly, always use entire weeks of data to even out potential weekday or weekend effects. Because depending on the product you're selling, maybe people browse your website during weekdays, but do the actual purchase during the weekend when they have more time. And always use multiple weeks of data. You don't want to accidentally make decisions based on one very good or one very bad week. My name is Irene Strikkers. If you have any questions, you can find me in the hallway track, of course, or on Slack or on X. And I will also share my slides on X soon. Thank you.
Excellent. Very interesting. It was a present for you.
Thank you.
Thank you for your talk. Thank you. An applause, please.